In the 1970s, the Big Apple was rotten to the core.
New York City in the middle of the 70s was a rough looking place.
New York was wilder than any Wild West town, and probably deadlier.
But amidst the ruins and squalor, a golden era of music was born. In downtown Manhattan, punk was created.
We single-handedly lowered the standards of an entire industry.
We are responsible for whatever happened.
In the Midtown, disco was king.
Studio 54 to me was really no different than what I was seeing at home. It was the same freshness.
Precisely in a downtrodden city, glamour means an awful lot.
Whilst on the streets of the Bronx, hip-hop sprung up.
We didn't have nothing here in the South Bronx. I mean, hip-hop really came because there was really nothing to do here.
I was a guy that never went downtown. I stayed in the neighborhood and formed a culture called hip-hop.
In 1970s New York, you could be whoever you wanted to be.
You can come to New York City, and I know it sounds corny, but you can really sort of fulfill your dream.
I always thought if you could make it in New York, you could make it anywhere.
I mean, if it doesn't work in New York, we're all in big fucking trouble.
New York, a sophisticated city with a refined musical tradition. In the 30s and 40s, Broadway swung to the crafted sounds of George Gershwin and Cole Porter.
It's lovely going through.
And in the 50s and early 60s, a new generation of Tin Pan Alley tunesmiths gathered in the Midtown's elegant Brill Building to fashion polished pop that would dominate the charts. However, in the late 60s, the musical zeitgeist went west to capture the optimism of a new generation. And with California taking center stage, New York felt like an abandoned city. Not since the Great Depression had the city been so racked with economic and social woe. Life downtown in the shadow of the skyscrapers could be tough.
Around the corner from me, you know, just a block away on that corner, all day long there was this swarm of about 11 or 12 year old kids, like a whole cluster of 30 or 40 of them shifting all the time. And they were there because they were runners for heroin buyers. At that time there was heroin everywhere.
The neighborhood I now residing in over on the east side was just like lethal. You know, when I was doing lots of cocaine, I knew 10 or more little stores I could just walk into and buy it at any given time, you know.
It was like that, like, you know, like a lot of burned buildings that were boarded up, you know, that kind of scene. The neighborhood we lived in was like, anyway, the Lower East Side was in urban decay.
There was a certain amount of danger. Where I lived, I would sometimes come home at like, 2 or 3 in the morning, and there would be gang members having knife fights using garbage can lids for shields in the middle of the street.
But amidst the squalor, there were bargains to be had. Rents could be cheap, especially if you were an arty type.
I mean, at the time, there were things called AIR. When I first moved, I had a loft down on Lisbonard Street. used to be you could have low rent if you went down to City Hall, showed them a painting and said, you're an artist, and they give you your address with a plaque in front of it saying, artist in residence. And that was all it needed.
Perhaps the most notable loft dweller was avant-garde artist and scene-maker Andy Warhol, whose Union Square studio was known simply as The Factory. In 1965, Warhol was looking to extend his artistic output into music, and he happened upon a similarly avant-garde band.
We're sponsoring a new band. It's called The Velvet Underground. And we're trying to, and we have this chance to combine music and art and films all together.
Warhol was a magician with a wand, because when he discovered the Velvets, they were playing their second ever gig, you know, their second show they ever played in some, you know, horrible little club in New York. And they were totally unknown and making no money. And he pulled them out of that. And within, by February, he had them playing a major show at the Cinematheque called Andy Warhol Uptight. And that was the beginning of the you know, multi-dimensional performances with the films and the dancers and the lights and all that.
The Velvet Underground were not native New Yorkers, but disaffected college students who'd been attracted to the seamy underbelly of Lower Manhattan and its promise of artistic, sexual, and chemical experimentation.
Up to Lexington, 125. Feel sick and dirty, more dead than alive.
The Velvets were essentially a kind of a gritty urban newsreel of what it was like to live on the lower East Side. And what they sang about was life on the fringe of New York existence, very far removed from the glitz of Times Square.
Well, Lower Manhattan was drug haven at the time. I mean, a lot of Lou and I's kind of worst experiences come from living down there.
But what they essentially did was show the other side of the peace and love coin.
You know, when Woodstock happened, I mean, you were happy that everybody got stuck in the mud. You know, it was just the whole flower children thing was just silly. And we were advocating, you know, giving everybody all the drugs they wanted, which wasn't weed.
Amidst of all the flower power ethic and all this, you know, sort of lightly hopeful music, here's this fucking dark, brooding album about heroin and death and murder, you know? So we all picked up on it, and that record is just a fantastic recording.
Recorded in just 2 days, the Velvet Underground's debut album was far removed from the polished pop coming out of the Brill Building, and both band and album failed to find success abroad or at home.
I think sometimes a prophet is without honor in one's hometown. But their template, that sense of gritty urban realism and sensual depravity and drug-induced hallucination, would prove very important for what would come after.
It's my wife and it's my life.
The Velvet Underground would become the imprint for a new generation of downtown New York bands. But in 1970, their lead singer would leave in search of his own success. And in 1972, Lou Reed would strike gold with an unlikely hit inspired by his experiences in downtown New York, Walk on the Wild Side.
Next thing you know, it's coming out every car window in New York, you know, and it really was one of those songs you heard every day 10 times, you know, you just couldn't get away from it.
Holly came from Miami, FLA, hitchhiked away across USA, plucked her eyebrows on the way, shaved her legs, and then he was a she. She says, hey, babe, take a walk on the wild side.
Well, he's doing that. It's the same thing he did in the Velvets, in the best music of the Velvets, which is to use the Warhol world as a sort of palette to take his stories from. Walk in the Wild says all about Warhol people, Joe D'Alessandro, Hollywood Lawn, Jackie Curtis.
Candy came from out on the island.
Lou's muses were drag queens who hung out at the Warhol factory.
But she never lost her head, even when she was given head. She says, hey, babe, take a walk on the wild side. Said, hey,
they were young men who came from outside the island. In New York, they could experience the sexual freedoms they craved and become everybody's darling.
I met Andy Warhol very soon on through the drag queens, through Candy Darling and Jackie Curtis. So I got to go up to the Silver Factory.
I call myself Candy Warhol now. Cashing in.
You know, I remember once I just walked from the elevator to a little way into the factory. I ended up with all these pills in my hand. And I was just looking at them, you know, and I started to take one or two. And Candy Darling came over and she said, oh, Lee, can I have the pink ones? I said, sure, why? What do you want the pink ones for? She said, you don't want to take them, dear. They'll make you grow breasts.
Whilst you could be whoever you wanted to be downtown, in the rest of New York, the moral majority still held sway. On such a small island, it was inevitable that the two worlds would collide.
Because if you don't flaunt it, who's going to know you're homosexual or not, you see? What they wanted to do was to flaunt it.
Security agent.
No, let him stay.
No.
Anita, let's pray. Anita, why don't you pray? That's all right.
Father, I want to ask that you forgive him.
That we love him.
And that we love him. And that we're praying for him to be delivered from his deviant lifestyle, Father.
And back in the summer of 69, a routine police raid at a gay bar in Christopher Street got out of hand and gave birth to sexual politics as well as a new musical movement.
New York, the thing that started the dance movement, I think, was the Stonewall riots. Basically, some gay people were partying in a bar, and there was a law that said two people of the same sex couldn't dance together. And so the police would come in every 3 months and regularly bust everybody in the gay bars.
They said, fuck this shit. We don't have to take this shit. Everybody else is marching. Even the people in a women's prison are going up against the wall. And then the black people are getting their rights. Everybody's getting their rights. And what's happening to the poor fags? They're coming into the clubs and beating us up and demanding to show our genitalia to prove what sex we are. Fuck you.
And they came in this one night, and this one drag queen didn't want to take it anymore, and she threw a bottle, and it started a riot which lasted the whole weekend. The cops got locked in the club, they were terrified, 7th Avenue was blocked.
We threw things, we turned back buses, drag queens that jumped up on police cars. It amazed people. I remember this hippie who was a political hippie. He used to say, oh, the fags will never organize. Oh, the fags and those crazy queens. All I want to do is wear makeup and prance around and listen to the Supremes. I'm living in shame, mama, I miss you. They'll never fight back. But on that night they did. They fought back. And that was the beginning of gay liberation as we know it today.
And it caused the mayor to change the law. And once the law was changed, it gave everybody, like, free rein to open someplace to dance for gay people.
The Stonewall riots gave birth to a new culture, and gay New York sprang out from the underground into dance parties held in downtown lofts, heralding the birth of club culture. The Key Loft party was hosted by the unlikely figure of Timothy Leary disciple David Mancuso.
Yeah. Certainly, LSD had a role in it, you know, but not entirely, no. Awesome. First of all, I was in a loft space, which was in 60, I got in 65. So it was very rare to be living in loft spaces in New York anyway. I had all this space, so, you know, and I was always into sound, so I started having parties in my loft space.